Now you're suddenly making gravity. You're surrounded by LED lights. We couldn't find a chair that these chairs are so deep and like you can kind of take a nap in them.
It's like Miller's Crossing or something. The guy's gonna come and throw his hat.
That's right.
Bane bomb.
Did you have a lovely time last night at New York Film Critics?
I did, actually.
It was kind of a nice evening,
it was
wasn't
it? It was kind of amazing. Yeah, I loved it. Harry Belafonte and Robert Redford. It was insane. It was amazing.
Do you like those rooms generally, or are you a?
I'm a sucker for that stuff. I gotta say, it's like it never gets old, at all. I mean, to be in a room with Robert Redford and Harry Belafonte and Cate Blanchett and Ethan Hawke and all these people, Jared Leto. I mean, it's like I don't know. I'm never like, oh, I gotta go hang out with these people I look up to. Oh, what a drag. It's like uncool to like being at those places, but I guess I'm uncool.
Well, you don't seem uncool at all, but you do seem like you actually are kind of a student of film.
I love film, absolutely. Yeah.
Since you were a little kid, or were you?
Yeah.
So, what did you grow up on? What was the what stuff you?
You know, grew up on 70 auteur filmmakers in America, basically because of my father. So, grew up watching David Lynch movies, Blue Velvet, and Hal Ashby, and Scorsese, and Bogdanovich, and.
So like when you were a kid, you saw
I'd say from like 10, 11 on. I think I saw The Elephant Man when I was 12. Saw Raging Bull when I was 12. And that was just when in Philadelphia, Prism, I don't know if you know what that, but that was like an HBO sort of spinoff, cable boxes had just come to the East Coast and Comcast and all of these sort of new frontier companies. Mm. And I remember that being a very cool thing because they're all just movies.
Well, I remember watching HBO and seeing the same movies, certain movies.
Oh, yeah,
like, over
I watched
and over
Popeye maybe 560 times, Robert Altman's Popeye.
A movie that he still, he doesn't still do it, but they always a little shy about it.
Yeah, of course.
Like, it was a hit. That was
the
funny
thing.
It was
great to hear, Harry Belafonte got up last night, and I turned to Russell and I said, I said, Kansas City, bro. And he had never seen it.
Huh.
And I said, oh, he's amazing in Kansas City. And then he talked about that he won New York Film Critics Award for Kansas City.
Yeah,
it was just so interesting.
But Altman was, I always get pissed off when Altman or Robert Williams would, make fun of or kind of shy away from Popeye. It was that movie did almost $60 million.
Oh, did it really?
It was like the eighth biggest movie of that year.
Oh, no kidding.
And people talk about it like a giant bomb.
Yeah, they do. I thought it was a bomb.
No, it wasn't. But commercially, it was successful and a huge DVD and VHS movie.
A $60 million musical.
Yeah. Well, with that music was, and the music is great in that movie.
Yeah, and what's her name was incredible.
Shelley Duvall.
Yeah,
yeah. But that whole cast of Altman people.
Oh, it was great. And his father was great. Mm-hmm. Yeah, my favorite Martian.
Yes, Ray Walston. Yeah. The great Ray Walston. Yeah. Always funny. Anyway, so David actually is kind of like doing a similar thing. It feels like this movie is kind of a. He now has like a group that he seems to be working with over and over again.
Yeah. I mean, I don't they all kind of... Well, no, maybe
no,
they don't.
Some,
you know, I mean, the Coen brothers certainly do.
Yeah.
Martin Scorsese obviously does. Yeah, I mean, I'm happy as hell to be a part of it. I feel like I haven't stopped working with them, in 3.5 years probably. You know, it's been sort of constant. You know, we went from Silver Linings right into pre-production of this movie, and then we just locked picture 2 weeks before the first screener went out. Mm. So...
And how did you end up being a producer on the picture?
I think it was something that organically happened during Silver Linings Playbook where we just, we sort of got each other, and I think I got exactly the kind of rhythm he loves to work within, and I got what kind of story he wanted to tell, and so that bled into the editing room, and he wanted me to be there with him, and so I was, and committed to that whole process, which was a bear. Utterly fulfilling, but it's like another whole section of that commitment. You know, actors come in and do the movie, and then you leave. And this was, both movies have been, being with him through the whole thing. So I loved it, and then it went well, and then it sort of made it official at the end of that movie, thanks to Harvey Weinstein. And then in the beginning of this movie, we said, let's just set the plate now. You'll be executive producer, so you could be there, and there's no questions. It's not awkward, and how come he is, and you know what I mean? It just became very clear, and it worked out, as if it's always supposed to be that way.
Do you think you'd want to do that more with people other than David, or?
It all depends on the relationship. You know what I mean? It all depends on... Yeah, I mean, my job as an actor is to help the director tell the story to the best, to help them as much as I can. So as much as they want me to be a part of their process, and I feel like I can add, I will do that, yeah, for sure. Mm.
So when did you first read Richie?
It's funny. I don't think I ever read Richie. We sort of created Richie. You know, the character that Eric Singer wrote was a far cry from Richie DiMaso. As a matter of fact, I don't think it even resembled at all. Hmm. And I think that was part of what the reason Richie was created was we wanted to make this antagonist, this FBI straight-laced guy that you would think normally in other movies would be almost as colorful as your protagonist. And sort of that decade, these sort of parameters would provide that dexterity for that character. So, you know, and then it was just a series of conversations and, you know, sort of just sort of spitballing ideas and talking about personal things. And we talked about the traits of the character a lot before we even got into the emotional core. And, you know, the curlers were a massive start jumping off point, and then that he chews his tongue. You know, these sort of things are quite influential of behavior.
David actually did the tongue chewing for us.
I did, yeah.
With an interview, and he actually like talked about
it.
Yeah,
it's right.
But he felt like it reshaped your entire head.
It kind of did, yeah. You know, someone close to me did it their whole life, so I knew it, and I mean, I could just feel it. So it definitely impacted me, and then we just, you know, we love this idea of Richie being this sort of petulant 15-year-old kid who just wanted to hang out with the cool kids and wanted to do right by his parents, his mother, really, and get out from under the rock he sees himself in, but he's in no position maturity-wise to deal with it, and you watch this guy just utterly flounder because of it. Mm.
So is it fun to play that, or you
kind of... Oh, it was wonderful. I was the best character I've ever played, for sure. I love Pat Soltano, but there's something about Richie DiMaso. Maybe because he felt so different from me, even aesthetically and behaviorally, that it was just such a wonderful escape. And it was also nice because we really did sort of meet the challenge we set for ourselves to create this guy to be something unique for the movie.
What does the collaboration add to the pleasure in actor, or is that a different hat in some way?
Oh, I think it adds to the actor. I think all actors feel that he makes them all feel that they are utterly collaborative with him. I mean, he went to every actor's home and talked about the character that he wanted to design for them. I mean, that is like... You get David Russell Taylor making his character, for Carmine Polito to meet Jeremy Renner, for Rosalind to meet Jennifer Lawrence, for Edith and Sydney to meet Amy, and Irving for Christian, and Michael Pena for the Tucson, you know, and Louis C.K. for Stoddard Thorson, and Alphonse Simone for Pauly Herman, you know.
It seems like, was it actually fun to make the movie?
Very fun, yeah.
Are David's sets fun? Were they fun?
Oh, they're amazing. Oh, yeah, they're very... You're incredible. They're full of energy. It's like you watch, you know, I think any visitor would just feel like, wow, any visitor who has visited prior a film set would, I think, oh, I've never been to a film set before like this. Because no one's in their trailer. Nobody's sitting in a chair. Everybody's there together. The camera operator, the boom operator feels like they're on the exact same level pecking order as the actor. There is no, it really does feel like there's kind of no hierarchy, you know, that it all stems from David, but then it's communal. That's wonderful.
And rare.
Very rare.
So do you guys all, the four of you, I would guess, work in a very different way, the four actors?
You know, here's the thing about whether or not our preparation is separate, we all work together pretty much the same way once we're on set, because that way is David's way. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have to give yourself over to, which is whatever you have prepared, however you thought you were going to do it, you better put that away, because he's going to demand that you do it in a way that's going to scare you and test you. And so basically what you find yourself surrounded by are people that are listening to you, because they don't know what the hell's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one thing that I've been saying recently, have the opportunity to say about Christian Bale, you know, I've idolized him since I was a kid as an actor, and always sort of saw the internal work, the external work, talking about what he does with his character. But that my takeaway from working with him is how generous he is to the other actors. I mean, Irving Rosenfeld was, yes, this embodiment, this creation, but he was very open and talking and just, you know, exploring and talking about things, and it was wonderful.
He seems incredibly happy these days.
It's interesting. I met a very happy guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, Christian does.
That's what I'm saying.
I'm saying, yeah.
Yeah, no, I met a very happy guy.
Because it's interesting, because David has that, you know, there's that weird thing about whether he's, you know, angry on set or whatever, and then.
But
Christian,
you know, I mean, it's sort of the utterly sacrilegious to air any of those things. Yeah. I mean, it's like, God, I mean, if you take any sort of private moment in my life or anybody else's life out of context, I mean, it's like the worst possible thing one could do, especially on a movie set where you're being creative and, you know. Yeah, it's a very unfortunate thing that both of those guys had to suffer.
It's been getting worse, I think.
I feel like nothing's come out recently, has it?
I don't know about any. Well, not about them particularly, but I'm saying in general.
Has it? Like, what other?
It feels
big
like Twitter now. Everything's like.
Oh, you know, I'm not on Twitter, so I don't know.
People are always wanting to talk about, you know, work product. I guess
right.
is really what it is.
Right.
We shouldn't know as an audience.
I agree. You know, it's the catch 22 of promoting movies, because ideally I don't want anybody to know anything about me, so that you can go into, not for any selfish reason,
right.
other than for the work, which is I want people to be able to go to the theater and not have to attach any preconceived idea to whoever I am, and then I could just be the best conduit for the author and the director. And anytime you get to know me personally, or what you think I am personally, you know, aren't you going to bring that to the theater? And sometimes that's a cool thing.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you can use it to your advantage. And directors have, I think, with people, you know, casting Nicole Kidman and Tom Cruise and Eyes Wide Shut, you know, I mean, casting a real married couple. And in this movie, it's actually interesting because it's sort of, I hate to even say it, but like on a meta level, I can't believe I just said it. weird, but I don't know how else to say it. But, you know, you're watching these characters put on these costumes in order to create an identity. And you're watching these actors who you've seen before in other manners put on these characters to create a different identity. And we sort of don't shy away from that. I mean, the opening shot is on Christian's belly. And the first thing I think everybody thinks about when it pans up is that's Christian Bale. Mm-hmm. Not, oh, who's this character?
Right.
You know, no one's thinking that. Everybody's going, holy shit, Christian Bale, is that uh-huh. like a fat suit? You know, right? I think. Am I wrong?
Yes, I think you're right.
I think everybody, and then they go into Irving Rosenfeld. Yeah. And then all of a sudden the door opens. It's almost like the curtains open. And then there's like, who's this woman with this very low cut, very sexy? Is that Amy Adams? You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then I come in and it's like, what's the Chia Head pet guy doing? You know? And then it just, and then we watch the Pompadour thing with Jeremy Renner. Yeah. It just keeps going from there.
Well, it's funny because everybody is going so against traditional character.
Right.
In this picture, all four of the, you know, main actor, really Jeremy too.
Yeah.
It's like, every one of them, I don't think Amy's ever really played sexy
I've never seen her like that.
Before.
Not like, I mean, the fighter, I thought she was very sexy, but
yeah,
not,
but
this,
a
is a whole,
kind of
this
sexy,
is a whole other
yeah.
thing. It's a whole other thing.
Like an overt sexy.
No, this is a whole other animal.
Yeah.
She's just, I've never seen her like this. And she's an incredibly dexterous actress, but I've never seen her like this in any movie.
Well, it's interesting to watch the stretch. I mean, it's just
yes.
a fascinating part of this movie experience is for all the actors, I think. Because Christian, we haven't seen a character like that from him really either at all.
No, not even close.
Yeah.
Not even close. A guy who probably never hit anybody in his life and shies away and is like a little teddy bear and a badger. I mean, it's Batman.
Yeah.
That's pretty incredible, you know. And the wonderful thing for me is, I mean, just imagine it, you know, I mean, because they are sort of outlandish characters in a lot of ways. So we're very grounded. And no one's winking at the audience. I mean, we're playing it dead, cold, serious. And let the comedy come from that. But, you know, for me as a personally, to be able to have Christian Bale believe that I'm Richie DiMaso. Do you know what I mean? In a scene is kind of wonderful. It's like, that's a lot of fuel. Like, wow, this guy's looking at me like I am Richie DiMaso. I kind of think I'm Richie DiMaso right now. Do you know what I mean? It's like when Robert De Niro was like, yeah, he's kind of looking at me like I'm his son. I guess I'm his son. You know, it's like this fuel that's, you know, high octane.
It's more meta.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. That's another layer of it. So do you know when you went to start shooting that you had Richie, or were you finding him as you went at all? Or?
The first day of shooting, we because we had come off of Silver Linings and we had such a rhythm going, we thought maybe it would behoove us to do the first day of Richie stuff just to get everything crackling. Because it had been some time since Christian and Amy had worked with David, and Jennifer wasn't due to come for 3 weeks. So we created a day that didn't exist, and we shot all of the apartment stuff. That was the first day. And I think, you know, the other producers went a little stir crazy because that's not normally what one does.
Right.
But we thought, let's just do it. And it was the right move because we did set a tone and get a rhythm going. And we did discover a lot of stuff that day. And then it's just one of those things, you know, the character's down, but you make huge discoveries. And especially when you're taking a lot of chances and exploring different avenues. Mm-hmm. For the actor, it's wonderful because your character is experiencing all these different things as this character. So each day it's richer and richer and richer.
Well, that home shots are all very Saturday Night Fever.
Yeah,
it feels very like
it is, you know. But one of the things that I love about that is what was sort of created in the editing room was when he then switched, when they hang up the phone with each other, and it's also very much say what's it, Doris Day. what's his name, Pillow the bathtop. Yeah, the bathtub conversation. You know, they're both in curlers talking to each other on the phone. And then on her, you start, the music comes in, the, what's her name? Is it Ella Fitzgerald or that music that feels almost like White Heat or something. Mm-hmm. And then you go back and he's in the wife beater, but now it doesn't feel so much Saturday Night Fever, but almost like he's James Cagney-esque talking to his mother. Do you know what I'm talking about? And you're like, whoa, what's happening? Mm-hmm. And I think that's sort of... that's an example of a director who really loves cinema and is taking the things that he loves in other films and letting it inject the enthusiasm he has for this movie. Same way in the Studio 54 scene, you know, Hal Ashby's very influenced by that in Shampoo, that scene with Warren Beatty's coming through to look for Goldie Hawn, you know, and the strobe starts.
Right.
And he has the white shirt, and we talked about that and sort of having that. And if you watch it, it's very similar, and it's almost, you could tell that was where the nugget of the idea came from.
So did you talk about that before, or you talked about that afterwards?
No, before, yeah.
So do you have a lot of those conversations? I mean, is that a circumstance of you being a producer also, or working on script, or does it?
Yeah.
Because do all the actors have that kind of conversation about what's
happening? I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Because that's pretty... does that distract you? Do you have to kind of like get that out of your head after you do it?
No. I think I operate the best in that way. I think I operate the best as an actor when I'm not thinking at all about Richie DiMaso. And being a part of working with David is, and I think in general since Silver Lining, almost since Limitless really, sort of the last thing I'm thinking about or caring about really is the character. And it's much more about the story itself and how we're going to tell the story. That's what I love. Mm.
So what was it like to go into Cameron Crowland after so much David?
It was wonderful. Yeah, I mean, it was a totally different energy, but the same amount of enthusiasm and an auteur nature, you know, I mean, and a writer-director again, you know. I mean, I'm very lucky. A great one. Such an incredible writer, my God. And someone who can write on the fly like David can, very similar. You know, another incredible ensemble that I was lucky to be a part of, Alec Baldwin, Bill Murray, Danny McBride, Rachel McAdams, Emma Stone. I mean, what an ensemble.
So do you come to that picture with a lot of different tools than you had before 2 years ago?
100%. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Completely changed, I'd say. Yeah, completely changed.
And is that... make you feel safer? Does it make you feel like you've got more power or control?
Not more power, but much more comfort in being able to, much more confidence in saying to a director, if you're open to it, I can help you. You know, with an idea, and you take it or leave it. But you know, I'm thinking for you know, I'm here for you, and I've gone through some experiences that have been very rich and I think I can help out. You know, if you want me to help, you know, help you in that way.
And Cameron's pretty open to that. He's like,
he's a very collaborative director, you know. But by the way, all the great directors are the egoless directors I've found, you know, who you know, and whether or not they actually are listening, you know, they're smart enough to make you feel like they're listening, so they're going to get whatever they want out of you as an actor anyway, you know.
But it sounds like you know that you know where that groove is. Between they really heard you and they really were taking care of you.
Yeah. I hope to God that my biggest fear, not fear, but I would really hate that any energy would be spared on trying to take care of me as a director. What a waste of time.
Well, I guess every actor needs a different handling,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah.
To some degree. But your preference clearly is all in. You want to be a collaborator.
I want to be in the trenches, yeah.
So does it inform what you will do for the next 5 years? I know you're going back to the theater this fall, I guess. Nice company.
Yeah, but before that, I have Clint Eastwood and American Sniper.
So that seems like a completely different experience than
we'll see. Yeah,
these guys.
And by the way, these two have been completely different. Yeah. You know,
because Clint gets he gets great performances, but it's all you're pretty much there working very simple. You know, not too many takes, not too much fussing around, just kind of go do it.
Well, there's not much fussing around on a David O. Russell set. Yeah. You know, we shot Silver Linings Playbook in 32 days. It was a 154-page script.
32 days.
Wow. I mean, pilots are shot in 32 days.
That's kind of breathtaking.
Yeah. So I'm not, it's not alien to me about moving fast.
So do you go into it going, I'm going to have the Clint Eastwood experience. That's what I want to have in this thing.
Oh, yeah. By the way, as much as I want to be a collaborator, I go into it going, I love this person's work. Their proof is in their work. So I will go in offer what I can. They can take or leave whatever they want. At the end of the day, I do what they want me to do.
Mm. And you're not on Twitter, you just said.
No.
But it's interesting because, I mean, the last time we chatted was about a year ago, a little over a year ago, for Silver Linings. And people were, it was actually got a lot of pushback on that interview because they thought I wasn't being respectful enough.
Really?
To you, yes. They thought you were irritated by me because I was like...
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh,
that I didn't know your, you know, because actually I didn't expect to be doing a single with you that day. So
right.
I hadn't prepped for it enough. And I didn't know your theater history and your other things you had done since that so much. So people felt I was like, but they love you. I think my real point wasn't that I was suffering, but that you, this people who are your fans,
right.
People who are watching your work really kind of adore you in this very
intense
way.
Well, that's lovely. Well, that's nice to hear.
Do you have that? Do you have any interaction with that experience or do you... Are you
no.
busy, too busy working?
interaction with people that are like fans, you mean?
Well, just the sense of how you fit in the community at this point, how people see you, perception.
Well, I think if you go on the internet, you'll get a very horrific sense of how you fit in the community. So outside of that, other than sort of a premieres where you see fans and you go over, that's always, thus far, that's been a wonderful experience. And my favorite part, actually, is going across the street and being able to meet fans and take photographs. I actually really love that. Because I remember being a kid waiting in line for 2.5 hours for Tug McGraw's autograph at the Ford dealership behind my house. Mm-hmm. And, you know, waiting in line and then getting it. It was, you know. Yeah, so that's actually exciting. But outside of that, I don't have much interaction.
So does the response inform you at all? I mean, does the obviously we're in award season. I'm sure if you get nominations and awards and things that you're grateful.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, does it inform your work in any way? Or just kind of is that a different part of the life?
Well, I think I think any positive feedback can't not inform your work. Any feedback, whether you decide to negate it in some way, whether you take it in. But, you know, look, if Silver Linings Playbook and American Hustle were completely panned and ridiculed and taught and to, you know, I think I'd be in a much different headspace today. Mm-hmm. But it's nice when you feel like something's working and then others who have no investment in you personally at all agree. That's that's a wonderful feeling, you know. There's nothing more exciting than being in the editing room and somebody passing by and just say, "Hey, you want to come in here for 1 second?" I think it's a great thing to do. Mm. Not even dependent on what they're saying. You could feel their energy in a room, how their body is, and it can inform you. It's always great to have fresh eyes on things.
Yeah, not to be a complete name dropper, but we were just shot Thelma Schoonmaker this morning, and they do a lot of in-house little screenings of Marty's movies, and she says you can actually see sometimes the entire room start shifting. If they're bored.
Oh, yeah. you know right away.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know in test screenings. You could just tell by a whole audience.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You could tell if your rhythm's off and that the moment that you want it to land doesn't because, oh, this whole other section just took up the space of the music and now we're screwed.
So you did all that with this movie as well?
Oh, huh? We tested this movie about 7 times, I think.
And you went to the test screening?
Yeah. As much as I could. I started shooting the Cameron movies, so I wasn't able to attend those, but I would be on one of the producer's cell phone speaker listening to everything.
Is that a strange feeling for an actor, though, to watch an audience react to the...
Oh, I sort of earned my stripes doing Limitless. That's when I was like, whew. Because they don't know you're there, you know, in those focus groups, and you better have thick skin, man.
But I assume you didn't have that experience on this movie.
No, you always do. You always do. There's always... It's not going to be 100%. Oh, absolutely. Silver Linings, too. We tested the hell out of that movie.
Well, that movie, I guess, got recut a number of different few times, and... Didn't they change it around a bit as you went around?
Well, I mean, no more than the normal process of editing a film and testing until you lock picture.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, we didn't reshoot anything. There was no additional photography for Silver Linings or American Hustle.
So if you have no ego about seeing yourself on the screen at this point? Or not
no.
In a positive way, I mean a negative way.
People
have a hard time watching themselves a lot.
Well, no, I don't have a hard time at all watching myself for the honesty of the moment as an actor, like seeing if that's bullshit or that's working or not. I could totally do that, I think, objectively. Mm. Don't ask me to tell you what I look like on screen. What I've managed to do is divorce myself from the utter shock of how, because I do, in my initial thing right away, I go, how do I make a living? It's just a joke. I really do. I look at the way I look. I mean, I don't know if most people, but that's just the way I feel. But at least I've divorced myself from that. Do you know what I mean? Okay, I don't even think about that anymore. So, and then I just focus on the work. Mm.
It's funny because it's exactly the opposite as I think a lot of people say about you. Is their first thing is, look at his eyes. Oh my God. You know, I get a lot of that. There are a lot of those comments on the internet about you.
Right.
Where people are just like amazed by looking at you.
Huh.
But apparently you don't necessarily feel that way. You see yourself.
Yeah.
I guess nobody really does.
Maybe, yeah.
When it comes down to it.
Yeah, it'd be nice to.
So does the idea of taking a breather, which it doesn't sound like you're going to have much time for, a part of your way of living, or are you go gadget?
You know, I feel, you know, people talk about, oh, you need a vacation or something. I don't, a vacation from what? I love my life. I feel I'm healthy, thank God. And, you know, I have these incredible directors that are interested in working with me, and I'm going to jump at that as long as there's enough time to prep and I feel like I can add to it, you know? Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Has it changed in terms, I guess there's a point where you don't have to chase quite as hard.
You know, it depends on the project. I still chase. I wrote an email to a director about 6 months ago about a project that I just felt so connected to and never got a response.
That's surprising.
Yeah, but you know, you never, you know, it's, yeah.
You just think professional courtesy would be enough to...
Oh, not in this business.
But I mean, does that change for you? Do you feel like now, okay, I'm in a place where you can slow it down and make choices instead of, you know, like I need to work or I need to go forward? Or
you're right. No, I don't feel that, you know, for 10 years it was just, you know, any job I want to then do the best I can with that job. And definitely after the Hangover movies and the success of Limitless, I think post that it was like, okay, let's... Well, let me see what if I can start to do things that I think that I really want to do and that can help expand whatever my growth as an actor and storyteller and people I want to work with. And yeah, definitely things changed after that.
Well, you seem so passionate about it.
I am.
I mean, I think the last conversation we had, the thing that was most surprising to me, having had the conversation, was how completely, like you could see the fire in you know, talking to you. You really, really give a shit.
I do give a shit. Yeah, and I think directors feel that, and I think that I hope that that's a very comforting thing to go, oh, well, this guy's not just showing up, and he's giving it everything he's got, and he's really in it with me in the trenches. I know if I was directing, I'd want that as from an actor. Mm.
Is it like The Hangover is a, you know, like a first girlfriend from high school that you still love, but is another life somehow?
Oh, no. Well, first, because Todd is one of probably my best friend, Phil, the director, so... I love him and see him all the time. So absolutely not. And constantly talk about doing something else together. And I those experiences were just as fulfilling as the David O. Russell experiences, you know, especially Hangover 1.
Yeah.
And those two guys, Zach and Ed, they're incredible. They're just incredible actors.
Yeah.
You know, so not even close. And I think Todd is, you know, he's just sort of at the precipice of what he can do. You can't really mess with his chops as a director.
Yeah. It seems like he just has to decide what he wants to, like, what muscle group he wants to figure out to do next.
What an exciting thing.
Yeah. Well, he's still pretty young. I mean...
Yeah, he's 42, 44.
He's been working for a long time.
He has. Yeah, since NYU. He made the G.G. Allen movie, which was great, that documentary.
So will Elephant Man be more... Will you be very involved with producing Elephant Man?
Yeah.
And making all those choices?
Yep. Well, there's really not many choices to make because we're trying to bring the whole production from Williamstown, all the actors, over to Broadway. You know, including a lot of the interns that were there. It'd be really great to just bring everybody, I think, because we had such a special experience over there 2 years ago when we did it, never thinking it would come to Broadway. And then, honestly, and I just, it's kind of, if you told me I could start rehearsal tomorrow on Elephant Man, I'd jump to it. I can't wait. I literally cannot wait.
It's the same director, everything else?
Everything's the same. Yeah. It's just obviously a different theater.
Right.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait.
And is the idea of being part of Broadway and that as a leading man exciting? Is that...
I did it about 6 years ago in a play called 3 Days of Rain with Julie Roberts and Paul Rudd, and we did a run along, you know, it's 96 shows, and that I definitely cut my teeth on that. Is that what you say, cut your teeth?
That's a good one. That's one way to say it.
I loved it. A whole other culture. You know, I love the everybody gathering afterwards, you know, and all their respective plays and having a drink at certain venues. And I love the whole thing.
And you foresee mixing and matching? I mean, is that...
Yeah, I mean,
it seems like it's a different kind of work in certain ways than...
Well, I mean, it is in the sense that you're telling the same story every night and with a new audience. And, you know, there's no action and cut. You're not editing it. You're not, you know, piecing it together later. It's all happening right now. In that way, it's a different animal completely. And you're telling it within a proscenium. There's no close-ups. I mean, it's all different. But the truth is the same, you know. Say what you mean and mean what you say, no matter what the the frame is.
Mm-hmm. But does it change your energy as a person? Do you?
Oh yeah,
just going through that for 6 months.
Oh, no question. It's all about conserving energy in between shows and adapting your life to those 2 hours you're on the stage. Yeah, it's a whole reorientation of your chemistry. And I don't even know what it's going to be like to play Merrick, frankly. You know, I did it for 2 weeks, and I had to get, you know, he even says it, Bernard Pomerantz, the playwright, in the preface that you should have a chiropractor or adjuster backstage because you are sort of contorted for 2 hours straight, especially the way that we're doing the play, which is he never breaks out once he goes in.
So,
and the hope is that it's not going to be hard for you like that, like, you know, you want it to be, you know.
Well, it's hard for, I mean, that's the actors.
It's hard for the actors, but the hope is, and the whole thing about the conceit of the thing is you're watching the actor come out on the stage as the actor, as a blank slate, and watch him create the illusion for himself and for us that he's John Merrick, and then hopefully then you're sort of in pain watching this contorting human, but instead seeing this character.
Well, you're empathetic to it. But I guess even in Hustle, it's, you know, I guess Christian had back problems because of just hunching over that
much. He did. I think he slipped a disc or something.
Yeah. That's what David said. So
yeah,
it doesn't take a lot.
No, it doesn't. One quick move away from utter pain.
Utter pain forever. Yeah. Oh, it's hard work. And that's what acting is all about.
Yeah.
So is directing coming up? Is that the next?
I'd love to. Directing would be incredible. But as long as I get the chance to work with these great directors, I'm going to take advantage of that until they won't let me do it anymore, because each time I learn something new.
So at this point, you'd say your director first choices, in terms of choices?
That I would work with a director before I direct a movie?
Well, no, that you would, that the script is important, but that you would, that who, the idea of working with director X?
I think director is the most important. And then, they're all, these are just shades of calibration. But I mean, yeah, you can have the best script in the world, and if you don't have the guy, the woman or man to put their lens on it, it's not worth a damn, you know?
Mm. But you have the experience of that person. I mean, that's what I'm saying. It's like the idea of, okay, I really want to work with Scorsese, or I really want to work with this one, or I really want to work with that one.
That's what I'm saying.
That's like, I got to go, even if the script is not exactly...
Well, the hope is one will
match.
That they wouldn't do something that
wouldn't
be interesting from the onset, just based on looking at their prior work. You know, there's nothing that Martin Scorsese's ever done that I would go, I probably don't want to do that. That's never happened.
And will you look back at this movie, American Hustle, 2 years from now and think about it? Or
I think so. Yeah, I think so. I think it's the biggest risk I've ever taken on film, for sure, playing a guy like this. And I think that, and I have such fond memories of taking such a big swing. So, I can't imagine that I wouldn't look back like, wow, man, that was some... made some big choices.
You look back at the other stuff? I mean, are you...
Oh, yeah, I'm very proud of Richie DiMaso, too, and Phil, frankly. From The Hangover and Sack Lodge, those are roles that stand out in my mind.
But they stick with you a little bit. It sounds like
in the sense that
some actors just like it's over.
Like if you say that word Sack Lodge, there's a thousand things that happen inside of me. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? Of memories, I think of like that guy. You know, so I guess that's what I mean.
You're in love.
I'm in love with those characters.
With acting, it sounds like.
I'm in love with storytelling. Yeah, that I am definitely in love with. There's nothing that to be a part of storytelling through the in cinema is I'm in love with that for sure.